Good day, everyone. This is Dr. Soper here, and today I'll be presenting part two of our lesson on reinforcement learning in the context of Thompson sampling and the famous multi-armed bandit problem. In the previous video in this series, we learned about the multi-armed bandit problem and how Thompson sampling can be used to solve that problem. You will certainly need that knowledge in order to really benefit from this video. So if you haven't yet had a chance to watch the previous video in this series, I would highly recommend that you do so before watching this video. This lesson focuses entirely on how to implement a reinforcement learning-based AI system that uses Thompson sampling to solve a real multi-armed bandit problem. So let's switch over to Python and get started. To begin, we'll briefly review our scenario. Imagine that you are at a casino and that you have $1,000 to play the slot machines. There are 6 slot machines available, and each turn playing a machine costs $1. The probability of winning on any given turn, which is called the conversion rate, is unknown and varies from machine to machine. In order to maximize your chances of winning, you would like to be able to identify the slot machine that has the highest conversion rate as quickly as possible. In this notebook, we'll implement a Thompson sampling-based AI system to help us achieve this goal. The first thing that we'll do is import the required libraries. Fortunately for this project, there is only one required library, NumPy. Next, we'll define the environment. Defining the environment is a critical part of any reinforcement learning project. Here we begin by defining the total number of turns, that is, the number of times we will play a slot machine. Since we have $1,000 available, and since each turn costs $1, we have a total of 1,000 turns. Next, we define the total number of slot machines. In this scenario, there are 6 slot machines available. We next define arrays where we can keep track of our wins and losses for each slot machine. As noted in the previous lesson, the number of past wins and losses for each slot machine will be used as shape parameters for the beta distribution. Next, we define a seed for the random number generator. This is only being done to ensure that our results are reproducible if we were to run the notebook multiple times. Next, we create a random conversion rate between 1% and 15% for each slot machine, and then print those conversion rates to the screen so that we can see what's happening inside the computer's memory. Remember that in a real-world scenario, the gambler would not know this information. Let's run this code cell and see what happens. As you can see, each slot machine has been assigned a different conversion rate, and machine 4 has the highest conversion rate. Remember that the conversion rate indicates how often a gambler will win if she plays that machine. The gambler, of course, would not know this information in advance. Only the casino would know this information. Now that we've defined the parameters of our environment, we can proceed with creating the primary dataset. Our dataset is simply a matrix that has one row for each turn and one column for each slot machine. In this scenario, our dataset thus contains 1,000 rows and 6 columns, because we have 1,000 turns and 6 possible slot machines. Each item in the matrix represents the outcome of what would happen if we were to play a particular slot machine on a particular turn. A value of 1 indicates that we would win, while a value of 0 indicates that we would lose. The matrix thus contains 6,000 possible outcomes, but only 1,000 of those outcomes will actually be observed, because we can only play one slot machine per turn. Remember that the number of wins for each slot machine is determined by its conversion rate. After using a few nested for loops to generate our dataset, we then print the first 15 rows of data to the screen so that we can get a sense of what the dataset looks like. Let's run this code cell. As you can see, the dataset is filled with ones and zeros. Each row represents a turn, and each column represents a slot machine. So each one or zero indicates whether we would win or lose if we played a particular slot machine on a particular turn. For example, On the first turn, we would lose no matter which slot machine we chose to play. On the second turn, we would win if we happened to play the second or fifth slot machine, and so on. The next code cell simply displays the means for each column in the dataset. These are the true conversion rates that we can expect for each slot machine in our simulation. Let's run the cell. As you can see, these values are close to the theoretical conversion rates that we defined earlier, but are not exact because wins and losses were generated with a random number generator, and there are only 1,000 turns in our dataset. If we specified a much larger dataset of turns, say 1 million turns, then we would expect these true conversion rates to be very close to the theoretical conversion rates for each slot machine. Next, we'll simulate playing the slot machines 1,000 times, with the constraint that we can only play one slot machine per turn. To run the simulation, we use a set of nested for loops, with the outer loop running once for each turn, and the inner loop running once for each possible slot machine. We begin each turn by setting the max beta variable to -1. This variable will be used to keep track of the largest beta value that we observe for this turn. Next, for each slot machine, we draw a random value from the slot machine's beta distribution, with the shape of the distribution being defined by the number of past wins and losses that we've had when we played that machine. We then check to see whether the slot machine's beta value is the largest that we've thus far observed for the current round. And if so, we set the value of the index of machine to play variable to the index of the current slot machine. Thus, after we have drawn and examined the beta values for all six slot machines, the index of the machine that had the largest beta value for this turn will be stored in the index of machine to play variable. We then play the selected slot machine by looking up the outcome in our dataset and record whether we won or lost by incrementing the appropriate element in either the number of positive rewards array or the number of negative rewards array. We then repeat the entire process until we have played all 1,000 rounds. Our AI system is continuously learning about the environment in each round, and is using its accumulated knowledge to decide whether to explore or exploit. After all 1,000 rounds are finished, we compute the total number of times that our AI agent played each slot machine, and then print the results to the screen. Let's run the code cell and see what happens. As you can see, our reinforcement learning-based AI system was able to correctly identify slot machine 4 as the machine with the highest probability of winning, and it played that machine on 695 of the 1,000 turns in an effort to try to maximize its cumulative rewards. Finally, it's always important to compare results such as these with a relevant baseline. In this case, the naive approach would be to just randomly choose a slot machine to play for each round. This last code cell does just that by computing how many times we would win if we randomly chose a slot machine to play for each turn. Let's run the code cell and see how this random sampling approach compares to our Thompson sampling approach. As you can see, the Thompson sampling approach yielded many more wins than if we had just used a naive, random sampling approach. Our gambler would therefore be very wise to use Thompson sampling. In this lesson, we applied what we've learned thus far in our series to solve a real-world decision problem. Specifically, we were able to successfully build a complete, reinforcement learning-based artificial intelligence system in Python that uses Thompson sampling to solve a real multi-armed bandit problem. At this point in our series, I hope you're beginning to develop a sense for how useful AI tools can be for supporting decision-making, and that you're starting to imagine some clever or innovative ways in which these technologies could be applied to other real-world problems. In the next video in this series, we'll see a more sophisticated version of Thompson sampling-based reinforcement learning being applied to a complex advertising campaign. So, Please join me for that video as well. Well, my friends, thus ends part 2 of our lesson on reinforcement learning in the context of Thompson sampling and the famous multi-armed bandit problem. I hope that you learned something interesting in this lesson, and until next time, have a great day.